The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us join together in our call to worship. In a world of uncertainty, we set aside this time to connect with faith.
We come carrying worries and fears, losses and dreams.
Ready to open our hearts to God's grace.
We come bearing the stresses of our week and conflicting concerns.
Ready to open our minds to God's word.
We come feeling overwhelmed and unsure of ourselves, with too much to manage and too little hope.
Ready to open our lives to God's Spirit.
We come as we are, to be embraced as we are by God's eternal love.
When Jesus the healer passed through Galilee, heal us today. The deaf came to hear and the blind came to see. Heal us, Lord Jesus. A paralyzed man was let down through a roof. Heal us today. His sins were forgiven, his walking the proof. Heal us, Lord Jesus. The death of his daughter caused Jairus to weep. Heal us today. The Lord took her hand and he raised her from sleep. Heal us, Lord Jesus. The 12 were commissioned and sent out in twos. Heal us today. To make the sick whole and to spread the good news. Heal us, Lord Jesus. There's still so much sickness and suffering today. Heal us today. We gather together for healing and pray. Heal us, Lord Jesus.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to all of you today, whoever you are, wherever you are, those live streaming, those listening in on 98.5 CKWR Radio or watching on YouTube. You are part of the Knox community this morning, and you are welcome here. The table is set today for communion. It's the tradition that at Knox that on most months, the first Sunday of the month is the Sunday we celebrate communion. We'll be doing that today. And you are welcome to join in. So grab something to drink and eat. It doesn't have to be bread and wine. The sacrament lies in the act of enjoying symbols of God's sustenance together. It's in our eating together that the sacrament lies. So grab what you can, and later on in the service, we will share communion together. We pray. Gracious God, we come to you today because you have come to us first. Yours is a story full of love. Sometimes we ask, who is God anyway? And then we remember that you have revealed to the world who you are and what you're like and what's important to you. We see you shining in the one we call Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. We see you shining in those around us who, when we have eyes to see, are far more than we usually give them credit for. We see you shining in church and temple and synagogue and mosque and in communities over the world where people gather to learn more about what it means to love. We see you shining, O God, in the renewal of our very selves, who, even though at times we are tired and weary, isolated and lonely, doubtful and cynical, we are those who can be made into new creations when we open ourselves to the mystery that is you. As we gather today to hear your story of creation and recreation, make us deeply aware of how you can expand our thinking, deepen our wondering, heighten our minds to be surprised by the Sacred Spirit moving around us and in us and through us, in our bodies and in this community. Open us, we pray. In the Spirit of Christ, we offer these prayers, both spoken and unspoken, and together God's people say, Amen. Amen. Anyone who's in Christ is a new creation. The old life in us is going away, and a new life has already been born in us and is being born in us this moment and will be born in us. We are grateful to God, the great mystery, for this amazing gift of grace. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
The peace of the heavens too.
The peace of the earth be with you.
The peace of the heavens too.
The peace of the rivers be with you.
The peace of the oceans too.
Deep peace falling over you. God's peace growing in you.
Today, I thought I would share with you this wonderful story called Sidewalk Flowers, and it is written by John Arno Lawson and illustrated by Sydney Smith. And it's actually a book with no words, which seems a little bit like an oxymoron, but the pictures tell the story. Sometimes I think as we walk through life, we spend our time so busy rushing through life, rushing through the familiar setting of our house and our neighborhood that we don't notice all of the ways that God is at work around us, all of the beauty that exists in the familiar. So this story is about a little girl. This little girl, as you can see, is wearing a red coat, and even her red coat lights up and is color in the midst of a bleak gray landscape. She is out on a normal day with her dad, running around through their neighborhood, running errands. And as you can see, her dad is pretty preoccupied and busy, often with his cell phone in his hand, talking and not really paying much attention to his daughter or to what is around them. But she notices things. She isn't rushing about. She is stopping to notice the beauty around her, and she starts to collect on their way beautiful flowers that some might think are weeds, but she sees the color and beauty in them. She's walking down the street, going past the market, crossing the streets, past alleys, under bridges, and in the most ordinary places, she finds flowers. Here, she finds a beautiful pink flower, and she picks it up and adds it to her collection. Next, she's walking down the street past a bunch of people who are waiting for the bus. None of them seem to have much excitement in them. They just seem to be standing there waiting. Her dad walks past, but she sees another flower. And it reminds her of the woman that she passes by with the colorful flowered dress. Then they walk past some stores, some windows that they have walked past probably most days of her life on the street. But she notices the beauty, the beautiful vases and colors in the window. And then she crouches down to pick up a flower in front of this really neat dragon. And she picks it up and adds it to her collection. They walk along the street, and there's another one that she picks up, and she notices the birds chirping and alive in her midst. Then they walk past all the buildings and into the park that they go through every day to get back home. In the park, she notices the wildlife and the trees, and she sees a bird resting on the sidewalk, and she realizes that the bird isn't alive anymore, that the bird has died. And she thinks back to her great-grandmother's funeral when they laid flowers on the casket. And so she puts some of those flowers that she's been collecting, and she puts it on the bird who is at rest to add some beauty to the sadness. They continue on, and normally they would just pass by people, but today she notices a man sleeping on a bench, and she puts some flowers into his shoe. They continue on, and things start to become more colorful. What was gray and dull and ordinary is becoming filled with life and color. They pass by a man on the street. Her dad stops to talk to him, but the dog seems to be being ignored, so she shakes his paw, and when she does so, she adds some flowers into his collar. They go down the street. They're finally on their own street, approaching home. She waves to her neighbors, and then she arrives at her house. She goes up the stairs, and she sees her mom and realizes anew how beautiful she is, and she puts some of the flowers into her mom's hair. When her dad comes up the stairs, he realizes the beauty in her mother with all the flowers in her hair. Then she goes into the backyard, and her siblings are playing, and she puts some flowers in them too, in their hair and in their stroller. Everything looks new again. So you see, this one little girl, as she goes through a regular, ordinary, familiar day, starts to see things differently. She sees the beauty all around her. I wonder how we can do that as we go through life, how things that we would normally overlook in our neighborhood, in our church, in our school, at work, might look a little bit different if we start to really pay attention to them. How we might find some unexpected treasures like the flowers in the sidewalk. This is my hope for you this week, that you find beauty in the familiar.
God shall get them that's not shall lose. So the Bible said, and it still is news. Mama may have, and Papa may have, But God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own. Yes, the strong get more, while the weak ones fade. Empty pockets don't even make the grave. Well, Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own. When you've got money, you've got lots of friends crowding around your door. But when you're gone and spending ends, they're not gonna come around no more, no more. Rich relations give you crust of bread and such. You can help yourself, but don't you take too much. Mama may have and Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own.
Scripture reading for today is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, verses 1 to 13. Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joses, and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except the staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the witness of the early church. Thanks be to God.
Mark is known for not wasting any time. He gets straight to the point. What he wants you to know most is that Jesus is powerful. Mark is like Jesus' publicist. He draws our attention to Jesus. Look at this guy. He is all powerful. He has power over law, over creation, over illness, even over death. This guy can do anything until today. Today, Jesus' power comes to a screeching halt. Like Superman in a room full of kryptonite, our hero is rendered powerless. Today, Mark hangs his head and says, "And he could do no deed of power here, except for healing just a few people." How? How is this even possible? The way that Mark tells the story, it has everything to do with the fact that Jesus went home. For many people, home can be an uplifting and comforting place. But it can also be a humbling and deflating place. At home, they know who you've been, and that leads them to think that they know who you are now. At home, they've watched you grow up. At home, they know your faults. At home, they've seen you naked, literally and figuratively. No matter who you've managed to become over the years, there's always somebody at every family reunion to remind you of who you used to be. When Jesus returns home to Nazareth, the townsfolk were not expecting Jesus to be the wise prophet of God. They were expecting to see little Jesus, who grew up around the corner. Or Jesus the carpenter, who had made their benches and tables. Jesus' teachings astound them, but they also strike a nerve. Familiarity hits home and turns into contempt. Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us? And then they took offense at him. In other words, they decided he is still the Jesus they have always known. And they reason that he is just one of them, not a miracle worker. What is it about familiarity that breeds contempt? I believe when we become too familiar with someone, we stop considering them at all. We disregard them. They become a fixture in our lives that we take for granted. And we assume that they will always be there, just as they've always been. We often stop treating them with respect. We also stop realizing that there is something new that they could contribute. We make assumptions and place certain expectations on them and leave little room for growth or transformation for them and for us. What if we let go of our preconceived notions of others? What if we stopped boxing them in? What if we allowed room for the unexpected in the familiar? Upon returning to Nazareth, Jesus also faces resistance to his ministry because his actions are countercultural. Jesus was likely the black sheep of his family and hometown. Because his life didn't follow the societal and cultural norms of his community, the expectations back then were that young Jewish men stayed put. They learned their father's trades, they got married, they contributed to the life of the family and the neighborhood. But not Jesus. Oh no, he went tearing off, running around the countryside, preaching about God as though the two of them were on a first name basis. He might as well have run away with the circus. Knowing this helps to give us a little context as to why the people of Nazareth react the way they do when Jesus shows up and starts preaching in his home environment. There is a charged exchange between Jesus and the townsfolk. The people in his hometown community come across as mean-spirited, jealous, and even mocking. Jesus doesn't react with grace, but instead frustration, saying, "Prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." Everywhere else that Jesus goes, his ministry sets on fire. It spreads like wildfire. His teachings and healings transform individuals and families and whole communities. Jesus' ministry career is wildly successful, but when he comes home, he experiences his first failure. Around his hometown, Jesus ran into such a wall of disbelief that it incapacitated him, or rather, it incapacitated them, his family and home community, and they took offense at him. Jesus, though, refuses to change. He stayed who he was in their presence. He still had power to share with them, only he could not do anything with it because they wouldn't let him. It was like he was pressing a lit match against a pile of wet sticks. It didn't matter how strong the flame was, nothing would catch fire. His power could not ignite them. Jesus held the match, a flame in his hand, until it burnt his fingers, and then he dropped it. And nothing caught fire in the synagogue in Nazareth that day. Jesus was amazed how closed off they were to him. And so he left them to go shine his light somewhere else, where it would catch and spread and transform. I wonder if you have ever felt this way when you've returned home. As if your education and training and experience and growth have been completely discounted, as if it didn't matter at all when you were home. In her book, Bread of Angels, Barbara Brown Taylor says, "We are like Jesus's family. We are the religious people whose religion can get in our own way. We are Jesus's hometown kin who do not always honor him. The biggest truth in this story tells us is that the community of faith is one of Jesus's toughest audiences, especially when what he says offends us. We have our own channels of power clearly marked, and we are suspicious of people who operate outside of them. We believe we know what is right and what is wrong, and we do not welcome anyone who challenges our beliefs. And yet God is dedicated to doing just that, because it is the only way to get us to believe in God more than we believe in our own beliefs. Jesus was not the only one God sent to shake things up. God is always sending people to disturb us, to wake us up, to yank our chains, to set us on fire. Because the worst thing that can happen to us, religiously speaking, is for us to hold perfectly still, without changing a thing until we turn in to fossils. God, she says, is not behind us, holding us back. God is ahead of us, calling us forward. God is all around us, speaking to us through the most unlikely people. Sometimes it is a mysterious stranger, but often, I suspect, it is people so familiar to us that we simply overlook them. It is our own children or our parents, our friends or our neighbors, all those hometown prophets who challenge us and love us and tell us who we are. The closer they are to us, the less likely we are to hear them. But what a waste of God's resources to ignore those who know us best. I wonder whom we take for granted. What wisdom, what deeds of power are we missing? Because we make judgments about how and through whom God's work can be done. Because of the limited perspective of the people of Nazareth, God tells us Jesus is rendered powerless. Jesus's powerlessness is not primarily about him, but about them, his family and his hometown community, and how they receive him. It is also about us, about those who are unwilling to believe the great things that God can do. Jesus' powerlessness is about those around him not being open to transformation. Often, just like the people in his hometown, we don't want to hear the things that Jesus is telling us. His words can often feel very uncomfortable. They call us to do things that would mean that we need to move and change and transform, that we need to face our fears, that we need to spend time with people we'd rather avoid, that we need to leave behind old ways of doing things and take risks to go in a new direction. I wonder what opportunities are missed and blessings lost because of our limited faith and perspective, or because of our view of others, or because of the ways we place limits on others. We often close doors of healing and renewed relationships, of new ways of teaching and learning, because we limit others. What limitations do we as a church place on others who might have been amazing teachers or could be partners in our ministry if we let them? I think about how women's roles in leadership have been limited in the church over the years and for so many years, and in some contexts continue to be limited today. I think about how we look down on or limit our children and youth as possible teachers and partners in ministry, how they have wisdom and perspective that we so desperately need as the church. How have we looked upon those of racial and ethnic minorities? Have we honored and respected them for the diversity and perspective that they bring to the table? Have we really honored them, or have we tried to ram our own ways of being, of interpreting, of practicing faith down their throats? And I wonder, have we really welcomed and uplifted and supported our LGBTQ+ siblings who have sensed God's call to eldership and ordained ministry? Far too often, we box people in, and we limit the ways in which they can contribute to and share in the transformative ministry of the church. We forget that we are richer when we include and we learn from others. God has filled us with the power to transform. God has filled each and every one of us with this power. Instead of forming preconceived notions about others, I wonder what would happen if we approached our interactions with others with curiosity and openness. Whether these people are in our family or in our church, at work or at school, or out in the wider community. How can we receive others in a way that assumes that they are powerful and invites them to share their power? It is my prayer that Knox Waterloo continues to strive to be a community where the power of God can be shared and caught and grow in beautiful and unexpected ways. Amen. Let us join together in our communion hymn.
Lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, love's abound. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, love's abound. Christ is able to make us one. at the table, he set the tone, teaching people to live, to bless, love in word and in deed express. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, love's abound. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, love's abound. Jesus calls us in, sends us out, bearing fruit in a world of doubt. Gives us love to tell, bread to share, God Emmanuel everywhere. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, love's abound. Jesus lives again, earth can breathe again, pass the word around, love's abound.
This is the table of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is not my table, it's not Courtney's table, this is not the table of Knox, Waterloo, this is not the table of the Presbyterian Church in Canada, this is Christ's table. And it is not me, not Courtney, who's host here today, it is Christ who hosts this sacrament, this meal. And our Lord invites you to come. Come not in your strength, but rather come in your weakness. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you the right to come, but rather because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord and you want to love the Lord a little bit more. Come because the Lord loves you and the Lord gives himself to you. Let this bread and this drink today be for us all the token and pledge of the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the community, the communion of the Holy Spirit, all meant for you and me, all meant for all of us. If we receive these gifts, if we're open hearts to receive these gifts in humble faith.
On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he sat with his friends for a meal. And he took bread and he offered it to them and said a prayer to God in thanksgiving. Likewise, we offer our prayers of thanksgiving to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you. With you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right, to give God thanks and praise.
O God, it is our greatest joy to give thanks and praise to you. For you created the heavens and the earth. You made us in your image, breathed into us the very breath of your life, and called us to be your people. Even when we turned from you, still you sought us and loved us and invited us back into covenant with you. And when the time was right, you came among us in Jesus Christ, showering your grace upon us. Therefore, we praise you and pray in unison, joining the whole creation to lift our hearts in joyful praise.
Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We give thanks to you, O God, for coming among us in Jesus, the one we call Christ. Through Christ, you told your story. You healed women who were sick. You befriended men who were lonely. You fed children who were hungry. You met people in their places of pain, sitting with them, comforting them, giving them your peace and a word of hope. And through the cross, you showed us that you understand our suffering. But you also showed that death is never the end of the story, for through the empty tomb, God showed to the world that even death does not have the last word. We trust that the Spirit of God may overcome any power that can hurt us or divide us from one another. O God, as we remember these, your acts of grace, we break this bread and we share this cup, giving thanks for your saving love as it is revealed to us in Christ. Great is the mystery of faith which we proclaim together. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. Pour out your Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. Help us, O God, to love as Christ loved. Knowing our own weakness, may we stand with you who stumble, with all who stumble, sharing in his suffering. May we remember all who suffer. Held in his love, may we embrace all whom the world denies, rejoicing in his forgiveness, may we forgive all who sin against us. Give us the strength to serve you faithfully, O God. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are you, loving God, now and forever. Amen. As Jesus taught the disciples, we say together,
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come,
your will be done on earth as in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us.
Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours,
now and forever.
Amen.
After giving thanks, Jesus took the bread, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Every time you eat it, remember me."
And after supper, he lifted the cup and said, "This cup is a sign of the new covenant, poured out for you for the healing of the world. Every time you drink this, remember me." These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. The bread of life for all who hunger.
The cup of compassion in a broken world. Loving God, we are so deeply grateful for the ways you come to us to fill us. We're grateful for this holy meal, this strange and wonderful way in which you choose to fill us with your very self. May we feel the strength of having been together today. May we feel the nourishment that comes to us through these symbols of bread and cup. Send us out into the world, we pray, that we may keep our eyes open for beauty, our hearts open to be surprised, even in the people we know the most deeply. Keep us faithful to the ministry and mission of Jesus Christ, we pray. Together, God's people say,
Amen.
Communion is really a beautiful symbol because gifts are given and gifts are received. It just keeps going around and around and around, the way love is given and received. It's hard to know sometimes where the giving ends and the receiving starts and vice versa. We are so grateful, we Knox, the whole community, you, everyone is grateful for the generosity of so many people in this congregation, people who love Knox, who love Christ, and who love the ministry that is happening in and through this faith community. Summertime can be kind of hard for the finances of our congregation. Just want to remind you of that. And so we are so grateful for all of the gifts you have provided as a community of faith and for the gifts which you will provide today and will provide through this summertime so that Knox will be ready when we reopen and start ministries again in the fall. We'll be ready to bravely go into the new world, whatever that world looks like in the fall. Let's take a few moments now as we enjoy some music from the choir and reflect on the giving and the receiving of gifts.
By the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my love?
I guess it's time for me to pray. let's pray together. God, we have been moved by the spirit and the words of the choir. It's a song of dedication, a song which reminds us that we are called to continually to offer our hearts, our lives, our gifts to you. Thank you for your promise and your presence. Thank you that you take us as we are and that you summon out what we can become. We offer ourselves to you, and we will hold people in our heart and serve you faithfully. In the Spirit of Christ, we pray. Amen. That was beautiful. Thank you, MC. Hours of work go into putting something like that together, and we can't ever take that for granted. Thanks to the choir and the music scholars for your singing and for you, for your leadership, and for your technological skills, which you have learned so well this year, MC. Thank you for that gift. Thank you, Courtney, for your message today, your message message of hope, message which contains some challenge to all of us to keep open, hearts, minds open. An important thing. We need to hear that message all the time because we need that reminding all the time, I think. And thank you as well to our faithful crew at the back. Today, we're grateful for Mark, grateful for Grant, for Kathleen, and for Maeve for being here today. Just a couple of brief announcements. One is the announcements of the banns of marriage. There is an intention of marriage between Allison Dijak, member of Knox Waterloo, and Matthew Rapolt on August the 28th, 2021, to take place at Breslau Mennonite Church. This is the one and only reading of the banns. And Allison and Matthew, we are happy for you, and we celebrate with you, and our prayers will surround you, not only on August the 28th, but also in the days which follow. We are very happy for you. And as well, a brief announcement on the reopening date, the hopeful reopening date of the Knox building for in-person worship. The COVID health and safety team met recently, and we have determined not to open through the summer. Waterloo is still a hot spot, but we are going to aim for a September the 12th reopening date for in-person worship. So you can mark that on your calendars, and of course, more details will follow, and of course, that will be subject to whatever the health guidelines and regulations are at the time. But fingers are crossed. We conclude our worship today with the singing of a beautiful old hymn, Lord of All Power.
I give you my all, if e'er I I disown you, I stumble and fall. But sworn in blood service, your word to obey, I walk in your freedom to the end of the way.
Go forward this day, ready to find God in the world, in small and surprising places, willing to see God at work in intriguing and unexpected ways, eager to serve God in the world, where you are, as you are, and as God calls you to love. Amen.
Oh, I lead you to the new places and points of view, roads to take, friends to make, more life to travel through. God, I lead you to the
I'm Hugh Donnelly, one of the ministers at Knox, Waterloo. Thank you for being a part of the worshiping community today. You can find us online at knoxwaterloo.ca, and you are always welcome to call us at 519-886-4150. This broadcast is made possible by you, listeners and friends of Knox, who support Knox's broadcast ministry. Please consider making a donation in gratitude as you are able, and may the peace of Christ be with you.